children, welcome back. Let's begin the second module of chapter 4 in political science, that is the working institution. Now in this module, children, we are going to understand the two more pillars of working institution. These are executive body and judiciary. So here, let's begin with these two topics. Let us know about the second pillar of the working institution, that is executive body or the executive assembly. So children, these executive body plays very important role in Indian democracy. They used to take the important decision of day-to-day life. They work on behalf of common people, but we need to remember that they cannot exercise as supreme power. So we need to understand this. Now here, these executive members in Indian democracy are being categorized into two parts. So these two are, number one, political executive, and number two is permanent executive. So here children, in this topic, two very important questions used to come that we need to remember, that is, what is the difference between political executive and permanent executive? Second question comes that why political executive is more powerful than permanent executive? So here we will understand with the help of explanation. So let us begin with the difference between these two. So first point towards the difference is that these political leaders, these political executives are being elected. These are being elected by the common people through election. Whereas these permanent executives are selected. They are being selected through the recruitment process. So here we can mention that these are being selected through recruitment process. Also, these permanent executives are called as the civil servants. These are called as civil servants. Now, second point is that the duration of their working, the working duration of these two, let us discuss these two points. So, political executive, they remain for short duration. They remain for short duration. As we all know, till the time of ruling party used to remain in the position, the ministers used to also remain in their places. Whereas, as much as their duration used to gets over, they also gets resigned. Now, in the same way, these executive member, they used to remain till the age of their service. Till the age of their service. So, here we can mention that they have long duration in comparison to political executives. Now, third and very important point regarding these two are that these political executives used to take the advices from permanent executives. They used to take advice from permanent executives. Whereas they used to suggest, advices to the political executive. So here only in the last point we can identify the answer of second question, that why political executive is more powerful than permanent executive. As the third point says that the taking of advice is being done by the permanent executive. Now, let us see with the example. Suppose here is the financial minister and he is the member of political executive. On the other hand, here is the member who is the financial advisor. He is the financial advisor and he is from the permanent executive. Now, by understanding this example, we will easily able to understand why political executive is more powerful than the permanent executive. Now, children, as we all know, the financial advisor, he will be more educated because he is being selected from the recruitment process, and has very good knowledge and experience about the financial matter. So his advices will be very fruitful for implementing and making any changes in the financial matter. So this finance minister, as we all know, in Indian democracy, the criteria for election, education is not the criteria for election. So here we can say that's why, but the implementation or the final ruling or the follow up of the any law or the decision will be done by the financial minister. So here we can say that this financial advisor will advise the things related to the financial matter to the financial minister, whereas the final decision of that suggestion or the advice will be done by the financial minister. That's why political executives are more powerful than the permanent executives. So children, the third and very important pillar of the Indian working institution is that judiciary. So our Indian judiciary is an independent judiciary, as our election commission used to remain independent. In the same manner, our Indian judiciary remains independent. Now, what is this independent? Independent means do not and never remains under the pressure of any government or any political or powerful party. Also, we can say Indian judiciary doesn't remain under the pressure of legislatures or executives. That's why it is an independent body. Now, children, here we need to understand, to resolve the nationwide disputes or the legal disputes, we have several courts, and that comes under the Indian judiciary. So these are basically categorized into three parts. Number one, the supreme one is Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is also called as Apex Court. And the Supreme Court used to resolve the disputes of nationwide, whereas for the resolution of state-wise disputes, we have High Court. And third one is Subordinate Court. The Subordinate Court is also called as District Court. So in this way, our Indian judiciary is being classified in this three manner. Now, one by one, we will see how the judges being appointed in the Supreme Court as well as High Court. There is a motion which is called as impeachment motion, through which we can remove the judges from the Supreme Court. So though it has never been happened in the Indian history of judiciary that any Supreme Court judge is being removed till now from the impeachment movement. So that's why we can say the strongest judiciary system the Indians have till now. Now, next comes the appointments of judges in the Supreme Court and High Court. We will see.
Here we are going to understand the Indian judicial system, the role of Supreme Court and High Court. The Indian judiciary comprises of the Supreme Court at the apex, followed by the High Court in different states and subordinate courts in the states. The Supreme Court, the High Court and the subordinate court are all linked to each other. Hence, judicial system is also known as an integrated judicial system. The judiciary is independent organ. The Supreme Court is the highest court in India. It is the guardian of the Indian Constitution. The Supreme Court of India is located at New Delhi. The Supreme Court comprises of Chief Justice and the maximum of 30 other judges. The Supreme Court hears and gives the ruling on both civil and criminal cases. The High Court is the highest court in the state. Each High Court in India has the jurisdiction of one or more state and union territories. Presently, there are 24 High Courts in India. Out of these, three High Courts have control over more than one state. A High Court consists of Chief Justice and other judges. The High Court deals with the cases such as those concerning to the fundamental rights of the citizen, election petition, and other civil and criminal cases. let us recap all the important points that we have covered in this topic. The Indian judiciary comprises of Supreme Court at the apex, followed by the High Court in the different states and subordinate courts in the district. The judiciary is an independent organ. The Supreme Court of India is located at New Delhi. It comprises of Chief Justice and maximum number of judges, that is 30. The Supreme Court hears and gives the ruling on both criminal cases. Each High Court in India has jurisdiction on both civil and criminal cases. The High Court deals with the case such as those concerning to the fundamental rights of the citizen and election petition and other civil criminal cases.
So this is the end of this chapter, dear children. After this chapter, going to release the new chapter with the new module. Till then, stay happy, stay safe.
It's time to do some questionnaire. Who appoint the Prime Minister in India? The Prime Minister of India is appointed by the President of India or the Chief Justice of India or Election Commission or none of these. Next question is, who appoints the Chief Justice of India? The Prime Minister of India, the Election Commission, the President of India or the Judge of Supreme Court. Last question is, name the institution where disputes between the citizen and the government are finally settled. These are Supreme Court, High Court, District Court or none of these. Answer all these questions in comment. Thank you for watching.